So before we kick off, I think the best way to do this is just tell us a little bit about your company, what you do, and what Theon really means.
Okay, thank you, Farah. First of all, thank you very much for being on this fantastic event here in Dubai. Theon is a startup in Germany based in Berlin, and we are developing battery cells which contain 3 times the energy than state-of-the-art batteries at 1/3 of the cost. You will ask me now, what? This is a wonder battery. No, that's not. It's just the application of the laws of physics and by choosing the right materials. It all goes through materials. And the material of choice in our case is sulfur. So we are replacing all this difficult to mine materials and to process like nickel, manganese, cobalt, iron phosphate, which is mainly processed in China and then transported to the world by sulfur. This is the fifth most relevant element by mass on Earth and a waste product from the oil industry. So we are transforming waste into value in our battery. It's clean, it's cheap, it's available geopolitically. And by the way, the reason why we are called Theon, this is the archaic Greek name of sulfur.
I really love that. It's such an interesting tidbit for me. So you sort of told us a little bit about why sulfur, but I want to get into that a little bit. We do have a visual, if you could pull it up on the screen, about how demand for electric vehicle components is still far outstripping supply for these elements. So how does sulfur come in that play? Is that sort of part of it? Because demand is so high at the moment. And in terms of cost, weight, availability, and even range, what does sulfur look like in those terms?
Yeah. Luckily for a company like ours who is in the battery business, demand will explode by factor 10 over the next 8 years until 2030. So up to 8 terawatt hours. And each quarter it's increased again. So the main part of the cost is material cost, 70%. So it's very important that there is enough material. And here we really need to choose a material which is available. And the second advantage after cost of sulfur is a very high energy content. So in such a battery, we can store really 3 times more energy. So that means we can extend range of an electric vehicle by factor 3. We can make electric flygle commercially available because instead of 1 hour, you can fly 3 hours. And this is a game changer to the eVTOL electric aircraft company. They have great aircrafts designed, but the battery is missing. And for stationary storage, it's very important having a cheap battery. And here again, sulfur costs 20 cents per kilogram. State-of-the-art materials cost 25 euros per kilogram. Imagine what big impact is that on cost side. So in a stationary system for storing renewable energy, we can make, with sulfur batteries, this affordable for everyone.
That's really, really exciting, I think. And I want to go back to something you mentioned in your first question, which is sulfur is a waste product of the oil industry. Mm-hmm. Being based here, this event taking place in COP28, the energy transition is a major theme for this region. How can you partner up here in the Gulf, and what are your plans in the region?
Mm-hmm. That is one of the main reasons to be here, and it's a perfect match, because really using a waste product from the oil industry and transforming it to value. Other battery companies, they are looking to being recycled. No, we are the recyclers with our batteries and using this material. And everywhere on Earth where it's a refinery, there is sulfur. There are mountains of sulfur. If we would build all battery cells in 2030 with sulfur technology, we would need 5% of the yearly sulfur production. So it's completely easy. Our plans to be here is to bring first development, a part of our development of battery cells to the region, and then to also build one of the first factories here. Because we believe, as we are thinking long-term, the region is thinking long-term, and we need the energy transition, that this is a perfect place to be.
And you did mention electric vehicles, planes, storing renewables. These are all sort of use cases for the batteries that you're producing, but why? First of all, who are potentially your customers? But secondly, why aren't companies like Tesla and Airbus already sort of adopting this change? Is it sort of, it needs more knowledge, needs more research? What is the barrier here?
Yeah, this is a very good question. state-of-the-art battery industry, they need to first amortize their big investments in gigafactories. So they are bound with their money on that end, and they have not always the means to think beyond state-of-the-art. They are looking to incremental improvements of the battery technology. It's up to us startups to think holistically beyond state-of-the-art, and that's what we did. And it's like 35 years ago when you remember we had nickel-cadmium batteries, and then Sony came with the first lithium-ion batteries, 3 times more energy density, 3 times cheaper. This is exactly where we are right now. So like 35 years ago, now is the time to change again to a new technology and being 3 times more efficient and 3 times cheaper, but at the same time with a very, very low CO2 footprint. That is very important. Yeah?
And do you think there are sort of challenges, or to you, what are the challenges that you're facing daily in your industry, and how are you planning to overcome them? High interest rates is one thing we've discussed, but also sort of maybe not the right investors that you're always coming across. Is that mm-hmm. an issue?
So obviously battery industry is not a technology development which you do in 2 weeks. It takes some years because each change of a new parameter in your system needs again cycling, charging and discharging of the new battery cell, and then we can change the next parameter and go to the next improvement. So it always takes time. What takes time needs money. So funding is a very important key success factor. This can accelerate the whole development. And secondly, having the right people on board. We are 16 experts, 10 nationalities, so we have really chosen the right people, not only from a technology competence, but specifically from the startup mindset, because it's not only what you do, it's how you do it.
Absolutely. And in our discussions ahead of the panel, you said there are 28 other startups in your field and that no one is in mass production. First of all, why is that the case? And second of all, what are your plans for mass production? And mm-hmm. do you plan to base it in Germany? Mm-hmm.
First of all, it's always good not to be the only company in one sector. So 28 other companies in lithium sulfur technology is great. But everyone has a different strategy, and some of them are over 10 years in the business. None is in mass production, as you said. We are the only company using sulfur in its crystal form. Mm-hmm. You know, carbon can be soft pencil or a diamond, yeah, depending of the property. And we have chosen the crystal structure, and this is excellent for having long life batteries with a very high energy density, proven by Drexel University in the US. So that is our differentiator compared to the others. From a perspective of mass production, yes, this is our target to become a cell manufacturer worldwide. We are in a development stage right now. We will have the first customer samples ready by the end of next year and plan to have the first, we call that small scale production line by 27, and then address the first market. The biggest market will be automotive because of our lightweight cell. It will be a 340 billion euro market in 2030. The next biggest market we can also address, will address, is stationary storage, 175 billion in 2030. So really, really great markets and excellent for us to address.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ulrich. Unfortunately, we have neared the end of this discussion, but don't worry, there are still a lot more exciting ones. And with that, I would like to welcome on the stage Ahmed Saeed Al-Khalili, Chief Strategy and Risk Officer at Mubadala Investment Company, for a conversation with Bloomberg and Kivalsky.